My name is Max Paoli. I work for the World Academy of Sciences, which is a UNESCO program unit based in Trieste, Italy. And the World Academy of Sciences, abbreviated as TWAS, supports science in developing countries. We promote programs to strengthen the work of scientists and researchers in those countries. In these presentations, the title of which is The Roles of Science and Education for Sustainable Development, I will offer you some reflections which I hope will be useful to you and to your work and your career path. So starting with sustainable development, it will be a bit of a risky start with a definition. Definitions are sometimes boring, but we'll focus on this definition. I'll read it with you. Sustainable development is development that meets the needs of the present without compromising the ability of future generations to meet their own needs. Please notice one of the most important aspects of this definition is not necessarily within the definition, but it's when it was coined, going back to 1987, so well over 30 years ago, by the World Commission on Environment and Development, also known as the Brundtland Commission, named by the United Nations to prepare a report called Our Common Future, in which a number of challenges were explored and defined, the most pressing ones listed on this next slide. As we know, the human population growth is exponential, and this is now putting demands on limited resources, on the energy that we require for the societal activities. These are associated with CO2 emissions, which cause changes in the climate. Population growth also causes pollution of air and water with associated degradation of the environment. We have the sprawl of cities, which are linked to the rise of infectious diseases, epidemics. Notice that this was already part of the so-called global challenges, even though many people are surprised in 2020 to see the rise of COVID. Antibiotic resistance is also associated with infectious diseases, and I put at the end, on purpose just to make a point, the loss of biodiversity, which should actually be the first one that we mentioned. So since 1987, a lot of work went on these global challenges, and what resulted at the end of last century was the so-called Millennium Development Goals that started in the year 2000 and had about a 15-year period time span. There were 8 of those goals, and as you can see here, most of them were based on human aspects. Only one of them, number 7, was really focusing on the planet. These goals were a little bit criticized for being, therefore, too anthropocentric. Some progress, however, was seen in a number of these, so that was really quite good. So the idea is that in 2015, some new goals were defined in order to tackle some of the remaining challenges. The new goals are shown here. They were published in towards the end of 2015. They are known as Sustainable Development Goals, abbreviated as SDGs. So you can see there are 17 of these goals now, as opposed to the previous 8. They are much more specific, and in fact, there is perhaps less anthropocentric perspective on these. We have at least 3 which very much focus on the planet. 13, 14, and 15, where 14 and 15 are solely based on life and biodiversity. I will put these into an interesting concept by these graphics published by the BBC, where we have a time scale on the x-axis, and the time scale goes from prehistory with the hunter-gatherer human societies, which are growing in numbers. So this is population growth, okay? But also, as the population is growing, we also have an increased use of energy, but is a good thing, also much more knowledge. The knowledge is reflected into technology, but our industrial capitalism has become consumer capitalism. And if I step back a second, you would see how this links very well with SDG number 12, which is responsible consumption. The global environmental impact follows successive worsening and increases at each one of these stages. So these graphics of by the BBC encompasses the global challenges in an interesting perspective. The global environmental impact underlines the fact that we have planetary ecological boundaries. These boundaries are also an interesting other aspect that the SDGs should be placed into a context, a planetary context. And what we see is that where we have the red, we have serious problems. So the biodiversity loss, geochemical flows with nitrogen and phosphorus because of the high use of fertilizers. We have areas that we don't really fully understand yet what the impact is on the planet. So there is still a lot to understand, but the idea, the concept of boundaries, limits of the planet, is something that the SDGs also would like us to think about. Something that must be clear, and we'll focus this presentation on that immediately, is the science and technologies are essential if we are to achieve and to follow a path of the SDGs. So in order to focus on science, I'd like to just as an example give you 3 to 4 roles that science has. The first one is obvious, that's why perhaps it's better to focus on the next three. But science can produce new knowledge. In particular, with that knowledge, we can explain mechanisms, phenomena, and changes. Often, we can have solutions and technologies that can address problems and help human lives. Perhaps most importantly, and we'll talk more about that later, science with that new knowledge can educate, guide, and sensitize. So I would like to give you some examples of producing new knowledge as well as explaining phenomena. In these examples, we start with a very current one, which is the COVID-19 pandemic that this year affected pretty much every country worldwide. Although people were very surprised and shocked by this pandemic, I would like to highlight to you a paper which was received for publication in November 2019. Notice that this was before the pandemic, before the outbreak of the pandemic. I read with you the title: Global Shifts in Mammalian Population Trends Reveal Key Predictors of Virus Spillover Risk. So what you can see is that the work that was carried out prior to November 2019 clearly identified an increased risk of virus spillover, therefore of zoonotic diseases and possible resulting pandemics. So science, and this is just an example, there are many more examples of similar papers, science is indeed on the right path for predicting and producing knowledge and pointing the finger to solutions. Just to reiterate this point, in this Nature review, also published in 2019, therefore encompasses a number of previous pieces of work. The title reads, A New 21st Century Science for Effective Epidemic Response. And once again, you can see how the problem that we're currently living was previously explored and worked on. And finally, just to give you an example of something very current, this Nature paper, just published in August 2020, reads, Zoonotic Host Diversity Increases in Human-Dominated Ecosystems. Again, you can imagine if this was published now, there's a whole body of work that's been going on previous to this, back into last year as well, so prior to this outbreak. So science is clearly producing a lot of knowledge and a lot of data and pointing to solutions and areas that we should be very careful and aware of. Now, I would like to give you another example of how science is leading us. And let's focus on a problem that perhaps was forgotten about because all our emphasis and focus in the last few months has been on the COVID-19 outbreak rather than on climate. In fact, this year, 2020, was meant to be the year for climate action. But unfortunately, this has not happened. Dr. Keeling, over the past decades, measured the CO2 concentrations and plotted them in this graph. In something that is now very well known, although very well known perhaps to the climate scientists, but not to most people, as the Keeling curve. In this slide, we see a larger picture of the Keeling curve with the May 2019 value of CO2 concentration, which superseded 415 parts per million, the first time in human history that this happened. However, everybody talks about CO2, but not many people talk about another greenhouse gas, which is methane. And the problem with methane is that it's a very powerful greenhouse gas. Per mass, it's about 20 times more powerful than CO2. So now I would like to give you four examples of how science is producing new knowledge and pointing to areas that we must be very careful in relation to methane. So the first example is the following. Rice fields or rice paddies in a Yale study are showing that there is a rapid rise in methane emission, and the reason is because of the anaerobic environment created within these fields. The second example comes from cattle, the same kind of biochemistry. Within the rumen of the cattle, you have an anaerobic environment which gives rise to very large amounts of methane, which are now thought to be much higher than previously estimated. The third example is the permafrost, thawing of which is causing the release of large amounts of methane. The fourth example is the work by Dr. Royer, which has shown unexpectedly that degradation of plastic by UV radiation is also leading to the production and release of methane. So we have four examples that point to one greenhouse gas being much, much more dominant in its rise, in its concentrations, than we previously expected or imagined. And this is very powerful gas, much more than CO2. So now the point is, with this new knowledge and with these explanations of mechanisms and phenomena, what are we doing with it? Is this new knowledge going anywhere? Do we hear governments and policies on methane or just CO2? I believe that most of us are hearing policies on CO2 and not effective even on that front. So we have a huge problem. And this problem is the great divide. The divide exists between policymakers and scientists. The knowledge and studies that the scientists are producing somehow are not being properly connected to the discourse, to the type of decisions and policies that are taking place at the government level. So this science policy gap is an extremely serious one, and is something that we must be aware of because it's limiting and hindering the role of science. Let me give you some examples of when this can succeed very well, at least two examples. The first one is in Kenya. Here you see an article published in 2017 whereby it was announced that Kenya was bringing about a very tough law, a ban on plastic bags with a very heavy fine. This is not the first country that did that, but it's certainly a very tough one. Now, I would like to point out to you who was the leader and the politician who succeeded to do this. The Kenya Minister for the Environment in 2017, when that came through, was Dr. Judy Wakungu. And notice that she has a BSc in geology, an MSc in geology, and a PhD in energy resource management. Perhaps the scientific background, and therefore the rational approach and strong knowledge of this minister, combined with her political will, allow this law to be approved and come through. So let's look at now a paper published 2 years later in 2019. Has the bound worked? Well, apparently, yes. They say that 80% of the population have stopped using plastic bags. And this is indeed fantastic, as over half of cattle near cities used to be found with plastic in their stomachs. But now, talking about cattle, let's look at a second example, I believe a successful example of science to policy interface working well. I showed you before studies where the methane emissions from cattle were found out to be much greater than previously estimated. Following these studies, many other studies have been published that said, as a consequence of that methane emissions, avoiding meat and dairy could be the single biggest way to reduce a personal impact on the Earth in terms of climate. Why? Because of the large amount of methane released by these animals. So there's plenty of studies that have been accumulating on this. Now, has this knowledge from science gone anywhere? The answer is yes. In this Nature paper, published in August 2019, we see that the UN, in a climate change report, calls for a change to human diet, eating less meat. So here, it's very interesting to see that the knowledge from science is going into and towards advice to policymakers. This is sadly not often the case, especially when we talk about climate change. We have seen that the leader, the new head of the Environmental Protection Agency, the EPA in the United States, denies basic science that we've understood for over a century. But next to these failures of policy, what we see in the news a Swedish young student that is actually attracting a lot of attention for the problems that are related to climate. And I would like to contrast this with a scientist who's also from Sweden. So both Greta and Svante are from Sweden, only that Svante Arrhenius lived quite some time before Greta. He won the Nobel Prize in 1903, and he's very famous for the so-called Arrhenius equation, one of the most important equations in science and in chemistry. It relates the speed of reactions and chemical processes to temperature and activation energy, an extremely important equation. However, I will not be talking to you about this. This is why he should be very well known. But what I would like to point out to you is this paper that he published in 1896. So you see the Philosophical Magazine and Journal of Science, and the title of the paper reads as follows: On the Influence of Carbonic Acid in the Air, which means CO2, upon the temperature of the ground. So he's talking about the greenhouse effect. And in this paper, he predicted that our combustion of fossil fuels and associated release of CO2 would greatly lead to an increase of temperature of the planet. Now, this was in 1896. What you see now in this Nature Climate Change paper, published in 2018, so 120 years later, the title reads, The Climate Responds to 5 Trillion Tons of Carbon. It's exactly the same message. Yes, with a lot of new data, much more data. Yes, with a lot of new techniques. Yes, much more advanced, but the basic message is the same. So 120 years later, scientists are still saying the same thing, and we're not going in the right direction, because 5 trillion tons of carbon is what will be released if we continue to burn fossil fuel. So my point that I was trying to make is that I struggle with this comparison of not of these two Swedish people, but of a young student and a great scientist. This young student is attracting much more attention than a great scientist that is also a Nobel Prize winner. This should make us think of what is the role of scientists. So rather than talking about the role of science, I'd like to switch and give you 4 examples of the roles of scientists. First of all, I think scientists should keep an open mind and a wide perspective. They should educate and communicate, perhaps more than what they do already. They should be a role model, and they should be aware of their moral and social responsibility. In particular, let me tell you about something particularly interesting and fascinating and good that is very much related to the role of scientists since 1987, so since the definition of sustainable development and the identification of the global challenges. I'd like to highlight the work of a number of scientists that united and combined their effort into what is known as the Union of Concerted Scientists. There were 2 key publications. Number 1 is called World Scientist Warning to Humanity, released in 1992, which was endorsed by over 1,500 of the most prominent scientists, including 196 Nobel Prizes. The publication number 2, The World Scientist Warning to Humanity, a second notice, published 25 years later. This was endorsed by over 15,000 scientists. Now, focusing on the second one, which was published in the Journal of Bioscience in 2017, 9 mega trends were revisited. They were already identified previously by these scientists, but they were revisited. These 9 mega trends are shown by the graphs here, and I invite you to study them and look at them. The part of the graph that is shown by the light gray line is the data up to the first paper that was published, while the one in thick black is the new data since that first publication. So what we see is that in some areas there's an improvement, but in most areas there is a worsening. There is an improvement for ozone depleters, where this has been decreasing, so that is a success. It's a success of science and a success of policy making. However, there are many other areas where the situation is getting worse. Freshwater resources per capita are decreasing. Number of dead zones are increasing. Total forest is decreasing. Vertebrate species abundance is decreasing. CO2 emissions are decreasing. The temperature change is increasing. The population of humans, and look, in this graph of human population, there's also ruminant livestock. Why ruminant and not all livestock? Well, ruminant because they have the rumen, they produce methane. So already then, this was a clearly known and looked at issue. So the work of the scientists has been going on for a number of years, has been published, has been proclaimed. Is it really getting across? From the results that we see, probably not as much. So the great divide, the science policy gap I mentioned before, is still a great issue, an issue of great concern. Therefore, what can scientists do in terms of their roles? Let's look at what I mean by keeping an open mind and a wide perspective. Science and research are often very focused pursuits. For example, if I'm a biochemist and I look at protein structure, I may never look at a paper like this one, but I should. This is a seminal paper. This paper in PNAS, published in 2017, announces that we are in the middle of the 6th mass extinction. So even if I were a physicist or I am a biochemist, I should still be aware, keeping a wide perspective and an open mind of key seminal papers in other fields and areas which affect us globally. Another example of keeping an open mind and a wide perspective is this example here that talks about a biodegradation of polystyrene by mealworms. Here they are eating away at the polystyrene. A fantastic outcome. So while the previous one of the sixth mass extinction was a little bit depressing, this one is actually a fantastic breakthrough of science. So we should be aware of this. Another aspect I would like to highlight is the moral and social responsibility. In conducting our research and our studies, we should always keep them in a context of moral responsibility and social context. For example, let me highlight to you certain words in this title of this paper: uncertainty and ignorance. This is about plastic, microplastic, and nanoplastics, which are being identified in this paper, and their possible consequences. So again, the authors are clearly being aware of their moral and social responsibilities. To remark more on this point, I would like to read with you the words of Konrad Lorenz, a zoologist from Austria. We live in an age in which it is the scientific researchers who are able to see specific dangers quite clearly. Therefore, they have a duty to speak out. Perhaps the most important of all the roles of scientists, in my opinion, would be the one to educate and to communicate. And I'd like to say a few concluding words about education and its potential. Education for sustainable development is an extremely important opportunity to raise awareness and communicate knowledge that is essential to proceed towards the SDGs. This education, this ESD initiative, was promoted by the United Nations that also announced a decade for education for sustainable development. And the initiative of this decade was led by UNESCO. The decade went from 2005 to 2014 and produced a number of guideline documents and protocols that could be implemented in schools, both at primary level and in higher education. The main outcome of this initiative is the following, and is highlighted by this statement I'd like to read with you from the United Nations Competencies for Sustainable Development. In order to halt the current model of unsustainable development, societies must work on a change of mind and/or behavior. So education is absolutely essential in order for people, for societies, for governments to act on this change. A very nice graphic by UNESCO is shown here, and it says, changing minds, not the climate. So you can see that there is quite a lot of work and propaganda trying to move people in this direction. To reiterate this point once more, I'd like to read with you the quote of Professor Shaw. Progress is impossible without change. And those who cannot change their mind cannot change anything. So I would like to provoke you into changing yourselves, and to do so, try to educate yourself. Start with educating yourselves, because ask yourselves, did you know about the paper on the sixth mass extinction? Did you know about the paper on mealworms? Did you know about the paper on the nature climate change, 5 trillion of CO2, etc., etc.? Even as scientists, you should be aware of other things. So there are massive open online courses known as MOOC or MOOCs. Educate yourself on the SDGs. Educate yourself on a particular SDG. Try to look beyond these colorful icons at the individual targets that are behind each one of these SDGs. Because if you do not, and if you do not succeed to go beyond your immediate focus of research, and you do not succeed to move your colleagues, your own students, for the for future generations, we will not succeed to go towards a sustainable development path, but will stay onto the business as usual path. So I thank you for your attention. I wish you to behold a vision of sustainability both in your mind and in your heart. So thank you very much. We may have time for two or three questions. Are there any questions?
Yes, please. First, I would like to thank you, Dr. Paoli, for your intervention. I think it was very informative. I have a question. You mentioned the Great Divide. So regarding the role of scientists, are you not asking them or expecting from them too much? How do you expect them to change the mind of politicians?
Yes, it's entirely possible that I gave the impression that I'm expecting too much. And I don't think that each single scientist should be expected to reach out to policymakers. Really, what we should think about is case-by-case basis and opportunities. Early career scientists are not necessarily at the stage to be able to do that. So if you're an early career scientist, you should think about your more immediate context. Can you change the mind and the behavior of your students? Can you change the mind and behavior of your colleagues? Can you do anything at your departmental level or university level? If instead you are a more established scientist, you may be already sitting in committees, perhaps already in the local council, so that's where you can start to act beyond the immediate area of your research. You should really think as any scientist to go into something called science diplomacy. Science diplomacy exists, and the World Academy of Sciences, TWAS, has been promoting science diplomacy for a number of years now, exists to bridge that gap between science and policy, to get a communication flow going between areas that seem completely distinct and separate, but they should be merging more towards each other.
Yeah, I have a question. You mentioned the Decade for Education for Sustainable Development. What did that initiative achieve?
Yeah, the Decade for Education for Sustainable Development was launched by the United Nations. Throughout those years, a number of documents were produced. These documents contain protocols, guidelines, and advice for teachers, for schools, for rectors and deans, in order to integrate into the education system principles of sustainable development, principles of environmental education, without which you cannot expect to grow and mature global citizens aware of the global challenges.
Yes, I also have a question. So your presentation focuses on science and education. Should nature play a bigger role in the sustainable development path?
Yes, indeed. It's a good point, a good thinking, in that science in itself looks at nature. But somehow, sometimes, it detaches itself from the natural world as such. And I think one problem is that science produces technology, and technology, you think about our smartphones, our cars, and so on, technology makes us sometimes detached from nature. So we tend to forget what are the laws of nature, what are the principles and mechanisms that regulate our lives, because we are, and we must understand, we are integrated with nature, we depend upon ecosystems. I think in the recent months, exactly during the COVID-19 discussions, even the ADG science of UNESCO, Shamila, highlighted the importance of reconnecting with nature in order to understand how important biodiversity is. In fact, the loss of biodiversity has been linked to the rising zoonotic diseases and the danger of future pandemics. So yeah, thank you for bringing up the point about nature. Nature should become a key central point of education for sustainable development.
Thank you.
Thank you. Okay.